So we will start with the IOM, the volcano, please.
Good morning to everybody. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In the beginning, I want to say special thanks to the special thanks to GSR for the hospitality of this meeting. As well, I want to say thanks to the International Seabed Authority for organizing this very important meeting, which we suppose that it will facilitate our knowledge about one of the important kinds of data which is required to study in the view of the recommendation of the LTC issues, of course. First of all, I want to introduce a little bit Inter-Ocean Metal Joint Organization. Inter-Ocean Metal, shortly named IOM, is one of the first final investors in the area with aim to carry out research on prospecting and exploration of polymetallic nodules. Inter-Ocean Metal is an international consortium set up in 1987 between six countries on the basis of intergovernment agreement. The headquarters of IOM is Szczecin, Poland. Exploration area of IOM is situated in the eastern part of the Varjon-Bertok zone. It's covered 75,000 square kilometers with depth ranging between 3,500 and 4,940 meters. Since its establishment, IOM carried out about 20 research cruises in the Clarion-Clipperton fracture zone. And huge data on geological properties of the area has been received. But in the view of baseline studies, research of IOM can be divided into two main phases. The first one is between 1994 and 2000, with in the program of the IOM Baltic Impact Experiment. Cruises for sample collection for this within this phase were carried out in 1995, 1997, and 2000. Second phases of the baseline studies started with the sign of the contract for exploration of with the International Seabed Authority. They started in 2001 and continued to present. Cruises for sample collection for studies of baseline studies in the view of biofauna have been done in 2009 and 2014. As I told, the main data regarding the biofauna was studied within the program of Baltic Impact Experiment. Objective of this study is to study effect of sediment redeposition of benthic communities in their habitat, including subsequent monitoring in 2, 5 and more years after the impact. For creating of this experiment, deep sea sediment suspendition system, the shortly called disturber built by sound ocean system, also used to create a stress on the venting environment. What is important of the study that male fauna is selected as a key biotic variable to assess effect of stress. In this slide, there are some pictures show the disturbance of the bottom sediment in some tracks. These tracks also obtained immediately after disturbance in 1995. These tracks also observed 2 years after the experiment. You can show, see that there also is visible. And this disturber tracks also observed, here is the one, also observed about 19 years after the disturbance. For the purpose of the BI experiment, sampling stations were selected in the three zones. First of zone is so-called control zone, where no disturbance was occurred. The next zone is impact zone, here between the disturbance tracks. And the third zone of investigation of Myobentus community was the zone, so-called zone of resedimentation of the processes. Area of study, benthic impact, IOM benthic impact area, is situated in the almost in the center of the most productive exploration blocks of the IOM area, where the nodule abundance, mean nodule abundance, is more than 10 kilograms per square meters. But the actually the BIE zone was selected in the fragment where no nodules have been there, because the most important purpose of this study is to estimate resedimentation disturbance and resedimentation, how its processes will involve impact on the community. Another type of station were collected about 1 mile south of the DC area, with nodulized area, and next set of data were collected during the last cruise in 2014 in this block also. They are collected not only in the disturbance area, three stations also in the nodulized area. Sampling location, this slide shows sampling location of the stations. As I told, myofauna sampling was collected in 1998 in the control area at 6 stations, in 1995 in post-disturbance area in 10 stations. During the first monitoring cruise in 1997, 11 multicore was sampled. In 1997, nodule area adjusted to BIE at 3 stations with nodules were also sampled. In 2000, the second monitoring cruise sampled 9 stations. In 2014, you can call it like third monitoring cruise. 3 stations were sampled within the disturbed area. And also, as I told, 6 boxcar stations were collected in the area around this VIA exploration area. Total of 48 stations during the IOM exploration activity were studied for myofauna up to date. Sampling method which we used, they could be divided on 2 types, depends of sampling units. Multicore sampling, with using multicore sample processing on board, including overland otter, osphonid, and passed through a 32 micrometer sieve, sediment core from the H tube. It usually we used 2 tubes of H station, was extruded and sliced into 9 intervals, which is included up to 3 centimeters at H half of centimeters, and 3 intervals additionally between 3, 4, 5 and 5, 6 centimeters. With each sediment layer was transferred to a separate gel and sample fixed by 10% formaldehyde and subsequently stained with rose bengal. When I used sampling unit boxcorer sample was subdivided into 2 equal subcorers. One of subcore was used for macrofaunal assessing. For myofaunal assessing, we used 2 tube core, which put or something like this, which put in the sediment with 9.5 centimeters in diameter. Also, we made the experiment. We used 5 randomly. Use 5 randomly tube walls with inner diameter 3-5 centimeters. And the sediment was sliced from the same intervals like sediment from the multicore. Sample processed in the onshore laboratory, including that each sediment sample was washed throughout a set of mesh size sieve 0.5 to limit macrofauna, 0.19, 009 and 0.032 millimeters. Each sieve reduced was examined under a sterile microscope and myobentic animals found being identified to the major taxa and enumerated. Specimens were transferred to small containers and stored by ethanol for the further more detailed identification. The data from each sediment layer was pulled to obtain core counts, and the animal count from the overlying water from the multicore tube were added to 0.5 centimeters of the sample. Next, some slide. In the next slide, I will present our results in the context of community structure, abundance, vertical distribution, and local diversity of myofaunal studies. In the beginning, I should mention that those data are without data received in 2014, which is in processing now. Community structure. total of 19 meters long tanks were found. Number of tanks in any one sample is ranging usually from 11 to 15. Most abundant is, no surprise, free living nematodes and herpeticoid copepods occur in the all sediment type samples. Myofauna abundance. Total myofauna abundance throughout the studies is changed in very big range from H4 from 86 to 394 individuals per 10 centimeters square, but mean abundance in the whole study is about 201 plus minus 24 individuals for 10 square kilometers. Contribution of nematodes to the total abundance lied between 76 to 88%, and the contribution of herpeticoid copepods range between 3 and 11 centimeters. Vertical distribution of total myofauna in sediment is shown this slide. There are very interesting subsurface local maximum between 0.5 and 1 to 0.5 centimeters in the depth interval. But myofauna up to 90% is concentrated in the uppermost 3 centimeters of the sediments. Vertical distribution of the main taxa, nematode and herpetoide. Its trends are similar, but herpetoide trend is more strongly decreased with the depth of the sediment. We tried to find some differences and compare data between two type in the studied area. One of is the nodule bearing seafloor in this picture, where the nodule abundance is more than 10 kilograms per square meter, and another type is typical for the BIE test site with absence of nodule at all, nodule free seafloor. These slides show differences between these two types of individuals found in nodule free and nodule found area. In the data from these studies or summarized in this table, where you can see the changes of parameters regarding the nodule free and myofauna in the nodule free and nodule bearing area. There are some differences in total abundance, also regarding the nematode abundance, that's all. When, as summarized this kind of data, we can say that the lower myofaunal abundance in the nodule bearing sediment was found, and a much higher proportion of myofauna accumulated in the uppermost sediment layer, a lower main proportion of nematodes in the total abundance, and a higher main contribution of herpeticoids, copepods to it, and certain differences in the taxonomic composition, which is very interesting, of nematodes and herpeticoids between the two habit studies show that three nematode genera were found only in the nodule bearing sediment, and four hypocotyloid genera were found only in the nodule bearing sediment. Local diversity in the IOM area was studied also. The degree of local alpha diversity was examined at the level of the genus with respect to the most abundant myobenthic metazoan nematodes and hypocotyloids, isolated for the uppermost 3 cm of sediment core, collected especially in 1998 and 1997. This data published this work, and the taxonomic analysis performed for those two taxa demonstrate that they occurred a high local diversities. The summary of information and numerical data are presented in the next tables. In these tables, we present the genus richest families and individual richest families, as well as individual richest genera, which are studied in respect to nematoda. And here are the characteristics, diversity characteristics of nematoda, which we have found in compare the data between 98 and 97. There are differences between genera, also supplying for 1% of the total individuals. Another component, taxon or hypocticoida, also be studied in the view of diversity. This table illustrates obtained data and diversity characteristic of hypocticoids. I'm sorry, I'm not biologist, and that's why I will put some data without comments, but I think it very interesting for biologists. And finally, conclusions. Myofauna in the IOM area was studied primarily, as I thought, in the respect of the IOM VIE experiment. And the entire sampling program resulted in the accumulation of an extensive data set of the temporary abundance and composition of myofauna throughout the studies. And in general, we can find that the myofaunal communities showed a well-developed dominant structure in which two major taxa, nematode and hypocticoida, dominate the assemblage. However, the data set is very specially limited, as most of the data pertain to the small, about 3 square kilometers area, test area, and a small area surrounding this area, this impacted zone. Limitation of data concerns also the habitat type, as the IOM VIO study was conducted within a nodule-free patch of seafloor. The myofaunal abundance and composition data reflect mental that type of habitat. However, we suppose that the data analysis of samples collected at 6 stations from the nodulized exploration block H22, which we carried out during the IOM 2014 cruise, will improve the existing body of knowledge on relationship between myofaunal communities and habitat time. This is the list of publications of IOM work in respect to myofaunal studies. I want to say that those kind of work was headed by Professor Teresa Radziejewska, who is now working for the in the University of Szczecin in Poland. There are some publications. That's all. Thank you for your attention.
We have some time for questions.
I noticed that in your cruise program, you switched from using a multi-corer to using a box corer. Can you tell me why you did that?
We're using multi-core only during the VI experiment because they're only technical problem. Because during the last cruise, we have not to obtain this multi-core
right.
On the
ship.
It's not because of choice of methodology or technology,
it's
the facility. Yes.
Okay, thank you. You're going to go back to a multi-corer future cruises?
I hope for Myofauna it's the best unit to use it. We have multi-core, but if somebody needs to use it, we can distribute this box core.
Right.
Teresa is the person analyzing the myofauna also from the last cruises you mentioned?
I hope he will be. But now we will study only macrofauna. Maybe the next year we will, because of financial problems, we will start with myofauna. It's waiting.
I'm just telling this because we have been there last year, you know?
We know.
And we said there was something with the media.
This era, we have
this
year.
This year, we have.
Yes,
this
I know.
and we gave all the samples to Teresa.
It will be very nice to compare this between two technologies and kind of research, I hope.
Thank you very much for your talk. I saw you have found those tiny ones and some of the smaller group. Where they store is a possibility that we could see them? Because it was a pretty high number you had.
There are really a huge number of specimens,
yeah.
Individuals. And when we carried out our taxonomic research,
yes.
We sent these samples to our subcontractors.
Yes.
And we have not received anything on back.
Okay.
But only for we started from the last year of Israel.
And the reason I ask is I have a lot of friends in Poland working in Krakow, in Poznan, and they always ask me where are they stored? I mean, where,
yeah.
How can we
it's
have a look on it?
It's a huge amount.
Yeah, there's not an expert that would like to have it up here.
Not a specific question for you, although but a general remark which maybe needs to be taken in discussion on not tomorrow but after tomorrow. If you show nice data of the vertical distribution of the myofauna, and my experience being on the same cruise that Peter just mentioned is, when there are not, so most of your data are from a nodule free area, and there you can nicely slice. But the moment you have nodules, you can't slice, and
yeah.
It's still in the recommendations of of ISA, so maybe that needs to be reconsidered if the slicing really makes sense. Because when there is a nodule, I mean your vertical profile is impossible to.
What are we doing?
That's we used a small diameter tubes, 3.5
small
tubes randomly with
push in the
box.
In a box core you can do that,
but
in a multi-core it's completely filled with sometimes with a nodule and you can collect the sediment, but you can't slice. But you need sub-sampling.
Well, during the captain cruise, we used cut-off syringes. 20 mil cutoffs or meters. There's some calls. Yeah, very small, very small samples, but
sometimes the densities are so low that you don't get a representative composition of the fauna.
Yeah.
So I think this vertical slicing is maybe something that needs to be discussed.
We developed a sort of technique for trying to slice cores with a lot of modules, but we could talk about maybe.
Okay.
It's a real problem, I agree.
Yeah.
Last question.
Well, Camilla, there were some interesting photos you showed of the tracks being covered over a period of time. And that's quite different from, say, the Iframare site, where there are other tracks, which it appears that there's been no change over the same period. So is that a difference between being in the east of the CCZ just being in the centre? Like, it's a very different type of environment. And the second question would be that in terms of the number of samples taken, presumably this was done remotely from a surface ship, and do you think that we should move to much more precision sampling with ROVs relative to where these tracks are to be able to really determine what the changes are over time of the fauna relative to the disturbance?
Okay. Of course, there are differences between the deep sea environment between the eastern part of Quadrantica in general and the central part. But as I remember, the tracks which were shown by Iframare, this is during the during the Domes works, I think. And there was used only a real miner to collect nodules, and those experimentals carried out in the nodulized area. In compared with the IOMBI experiment, it was carried out in the area without nodules, and our aim of this study was to estimate one other components of the impact. This is the sedimentation and how, because you know more than 40%, about the 44% of the nodules were surrounded by sediment, and during the mining the sediment mobilization and redeposition will be also the biggest problem on the environment. And that's why in the track we can see in the compare data on physical properties of in the area, also chemical. There are also compare data from myobantu studies during the differences. But we can say that during the quiz in 1997, about 24 months after this experiment, the myobantus was reestablished. More density of was found there. It's very difficult to say how it is to estimate in general. And regarding your second question, we try to use deep sea device, photo devices only, and to make sample profiling which across the DOS area. And I should say that we very difficult to find 2 days spent for to ask where is the actual zone loss. It is very interesting. But as I know, during the geomark research, they find easier these tracks.
So the tracks are still there?
The tracks are still there, but it's a smooth more smooth in the in the beginning.
Thank you, Volkan. And,